Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of Learn with Jason. Today on the show, we have Maya Shavin. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
It's
so great to be here.
Yeah, it's going to be a great day. I am really looking forward to this because we are going to be learning something that I don't know and using something that I kind of know and really enjoy, which I don't know Nuxt really at all. We did an episode way back in the day where Shirley Wu and I tried to figure it out, and we did okay, but we didn't get far. And then we're going to use that in combination with Cloudinary, which is one of my favorite tools for just dealing with images in general on the web. So I'm really looking forward to this one. But before we talk about all of that, for those of us who aren't familiar with your work, can you give us a little bit of a background on yourself?
Well, I'm a senior front-end developer in Cloudinary. So I was working mainly on the DAM, which is the console application for Cloudinary. Okay. And recently, I started working on the more about the developer community, like building all the tools for Cloudinary. And Nuxt plugin is one of them, the works that I've done. And basically, whatever you ask for to make your life easier with Cloudinary is my job.
Nice. Yeah. Well, I feel like that's sort of my favorite place to be as a developer, is in a position to just like try to make things easier for other people. So I love that. How do you like that job? Is it fun?
It's fun. It's super fun. And it's also very challenging. Let's put it this way, like you deal with a lot of the different aspect, the different user requirement, and developer have a lot of requirements.
That's the politest way of describing it. Yes, absolutely.
I'm trying to be polite.
So today we are going to dig into Cloudinary, and we're going to look at how we can use that with Nuxt, and specifically kind of like a getting started with Nuxt, because I feel like, especially for myself, I have done very, very little with Vue in general and almost nothing with Nuxt. So I'm really excited to get my hands dirty and just kind of learn what it's capable of, what we can do with it. So what would you say is, like, why would someone use Nuxt? What are its kind of big feature points?
Well, first of all, a developer experience is really super easy to get started. And it's very easy to understand how to work with it because it built on top of Vue. And as you know, Vue is very well known for easy to learn and have a very good documentation. So yeah, if you love Vue, Nuxt is definitely something you should check out.
Awesome. So I'm super excited for this because I've seen a little bit of Vue stuff, and every time I see it, I love the approachability of it. I think that it's you know, the single file component approach always makes me happy. I love that you get to put everything together without having to change syntaxes. I like that I get to just write CSS, but I don't have to put it in a separate file or do CSS and JS or wrap it in a template tag. Like, all of those things it's a really nice developer experience. What is your favorite, or what drove you to write Vue in the first place? Kind of what got you to start writing it?
Oh, well, that's an interesting question, because I actually work mainly with React.
Oh, cool. Okay. All right.
Yeah. So it got funny because I knew Vue before, and I started with Vue because I have to migrate a whole project from Angular 1 to Vue.
Okay.
Basically, I was in charge of choosing which framework to migrate to, and React doesn't bite me. So I chose Vue to make my life easier.
Okay.
Yeah, in the end, I haven't finished that migration, but I joined Cloudinary, and Cloudinary pulled me back to React. So kind of in the middle. And then I'm still, basically, I like React, I like both of them, but my heart belongs to Vue.
Okay.
Because I have a Vue.
No, I think that's, I actually think that's a really good way to say it, because I like a lot of, like, I really like working with a lot of tools, but ultimately, you know, I have my preferences. So my heart belongs to Vue is a great way to put that. I think that's really nice. So I'm actually really excited to just go ahead and jump right in. So let's switch over into the pair programming view. And while we're doing that, I'm going to do a quick shout out to our sponsors. We have live captioning for the show at lwj.dev/live. So if you want to see that, you can head over there. That live captioning is being provided by White Coat Captioning. Thank you to Tess, who's with us today. And White Coat Captioning is possible for us because of the generous sponsorships of Netlify, Fauna, Sanity, and Auth0, who all pitch in to make this show more accessible to more people, which we deeply appreciate.
Wow, the transcript is great.
It makes me really, really happy. And this is also available on the show when it gets posted tomorrow. Also, make sure you go and follow Maya on Twitter. And
follow me.
definitely go follow Maya. Lots of good information there, lots of helpful information, and a great person to reach out to if you have Cloudinary questions. And so today we're going to be working with Nuxt. So I'm going to drop a couple links here, and we're going to be working with Cloudinary. And I found out right before this call, there's a whole library specially built for using Cloudinary with Nuxt. So we're going to dig into that a little bit. So if I want to get started, what should my first step be?
Well, first you need to create a Nuxt project.
Okay, so I'm going to get...
You can get started, I guess. Recently, Debbie from the Nuxt team make a great effort in changing the Nuxt documentation, so it will be so great. Okay. And yeah, I'm shouting out to Debbie if she's on the chat. Normally she will be, but I'm not sure she's here today.
Okay, so I have, let's see, we've got Node, I have Node, I have VS Code.
And one.
And a terminal.
At least version 10, yeah.
Let's see, let's check what version I'm running. 14. All right.
Okay, cool.
So, should I use create Nuxt app?
Yeah. Let's okay. Yarn create Nuxt app.
Okay, so yarn create Nuxt app, and we will call this Let's Learn Nuxt. And while we're waiting for that, we can go take a look at what happens next. So we're going to move into it. Oh, and we can just start it right up. Oh, wow.
Well, yeah, there's a little bit of configuration. You need to set it up beforehand, but it's going to take a while, very fast. It only depends on how quick your downloading going to be. You know how it is with NPM packages.
Yeah. Oh, come on, do it. I'm on the good internet. This should be real fast. So let's see. Here we go. Get my 27,601 packages.
Wow.
Okay.
Okay, the approach.
Should we use JavaScript or TypeScript today?
Yeah. Not TypeScript for today. I have enough TypeScript for the whole week.
Okay.
I spent the whole 2 days just to figure out how to set up the type correctly, or it would not scream at me.
Okay, so we got in the UI framework. Do we want any UI framework today?
If you like Tailwinds, I always go for Tailwinds 24 because it gives me the basic nice kind of nice feeling, and I don't have to write a lot of CSS.
Okay.
Maybe content.
Okay.
Let's do content. And it's all up to you. If you wanted to scream at you every time you type something, then yeah, go for ESLint.
Maybe I'll add prettier just so that it auto formats on save. But I'll leave everything else. So let's do that. We're not going to cover testing today, so I should probably leave that out.
Yeah.
Okay.
Universal.
Okay.
Universal mean that it actually servers are rendering and it's also static.
Static. Static. Okay.
Static. Yeah.
JS config.
Well, everyone loves Jamstack nowadays, so yeah.
I mean, I know I do. let's see. Do we need any of these, do you think? Recommended for VS Code if you're not. Okay.
Yeah, I normally choose that one.
Okay. Continuous integration. Oh, well, we can set it up with Netlify later if we get there. Version control, we'll use Git.
Well, sometimes when I have this kind of configuration panel, it's always like, I don't want to choose everything. It takes so long to set up a project. But then when I set up a project, I always want to have some kind of configuration on the CLI, like kind of conflicts here.
Yeah. Yeah, it looks
GitHub
like
GitHub base out of the box. No. Sorry.
But no, it's really cool that it does let you kind of get all those pieces pre-configured. And I like that it makes them optional. Like, one of the things that I don't like about starter kits is when all I want is to get started quickly and I end up with somebody's, like, all of their opinions instead of just the ones that I needed, right? If I, like,
right.
I remember with a lot of React projects where you would start and then you would have to go in and remove a bunch of things because there was all this boilerplate you didn't need. So I think that's really thoughtful that when you do this, like, it's kind of a pain to have to make all those decisions, but it's way nicer than having to go in and remove those decisions from the code later on.
Right. I agree with you. I still remember how terrified I see create React app.
Mm-hmm. Nikki, I don't think the create scripts can be run again unless Nuxt is doing something special. So I think this is kind of like a you make a decision and that's final, right?
Right. If you run it again, it kind of either throw you an error or it override the whole project from beginning. So, yeah.
Okay. So this is actually running now. So I can do the getting started docs that I could run yarn dev. So I'm just going to do that. And that runs the Nuxt command. Am I interested in participation? Sure, I'll send you some data.
Oh, that's new. I didn't know that.
And now I think I can go to localhost 3000. So I'm going to copy paste this while we wait. I like that. That's nice to show the progress. Good. Okay.
Well, Debbie was telling me that they're thinking of showing some tips and tricks on the waiting screen. So it's like it throw you a random joke in the middle of that so you can have a laugh if you're waiting.
I like that. That sounds fun. Okay. So my computer has decided to beach ball of death. I really hope that's not going to do what I think it's going to do. Let's see what I can quit.
You have it, okay. Everyone have a Mac, right?
Yeah, this is
my first live stream with Debbie also. We stuck in the middle because Mac decided that it's time to take a break.
Okay, so it looks like we're okay. I just closed my other browser windows to make sure that I don't get into trouble. And we are now looking at the default page. And this looks really nice. So it's my project name, it's got a link to the documentation and a link to the Nuxt GitHub. Sweet, okay. What should we do next?
Okay, so we're talking about Cloudinary, so let's install the Cloudinary module for Nuxt.
Okay, so here's the documentation for that, cloudinary.nuxtjs.org. Drop another link there. And this is I'm going to install this one. @nuxjs/cloudinary.
Yeah. So you can
are there
just
any
go
other
to
dependencies?
Setup also. No, you can just go to the setup, I think, and
there
then just copy it. Yeah.
Perfect. Okay. So let's stop here. I'm going to install this and let's look at the config. It says @nuxjs in the module section of nux.config.js. Okay. So I'm going to copy this. And let's go in here, and here's our nux.js.config. And we've got modules, so I copied more than I needed to. So let's bring this up here and delete the rest of it. Okay. Prettier's helping. All right, so Nuxt.js Cloudinary is now installed as a module. And so what does this plugin do?
Well, it do a lot of a bunch of things. It,
okay.
First, it can it allow you to do to compute, like to make the URL from your public ID, the asset public ID, and okay. the whole transformation, whatever the, on the fly.
Okay.
Or it also allow you to upload a resource on the build time or on client side, depending on what mode you are using. And it have a bunch of components, the view component that you can already can use instead of calling the URL generation, is you can view the view component yourself on the client side, on the template.
Okay.
Have a lot of things. So let's just start from the simplest thing first.
Yeah. So we start out with, we need to add a Cloudinary config, and my cloud name is Jay Langsdorf. So we can add that, and then I'm going to add a link to this so that we can find it again. Now, once this is set, it says we're all set. Great. So at this point, I mean, we've set up a whole site, and now the create app kind of did the work for us. So I'm just going to take a peek in here and see what we've got. Let's see, the assets folder is empty. The layouts folder has a default. There's an empty middleware folder. No plugins, no store, favicon, and we looked at this this Nuxt.js, and everything else is kind of boilerplatey. So it looks like this is where we start. We've got our index, and this is what we're looking at on the homepage, right? So I think if I go back out here, and I restart the site. Let's play this way. I'll get this one set up here and this one set up here. And then we can do like a hi chat. And I think once this finishes loading, it'll actually hot reload for us. You good? There it goes. Okay. So now we have the ability to just kind of edit in here, and this is kind of what I was talking about with Nuxt being, or with Vue being single file. So it uses a template tag, and then a script tag, and then a style tag, and in each of these, like these aren't magic, right? It's not like, so like React has JSX, which is a specialized syntax. Is there anything aside from the fact that these single file components exist, like, are we writing a JSX style thing, or is this is plain JavaScript, this is plain CSS, this is plain HTML?
Yes, this is like in template you write a plain HTML, in script you write plain JavaScript, and in style tag you write absolutely either CSS, or you can also write SCSS or CSS module inside it. It really depends on which one you want. And another thing is, if you add in the style, if you add scope, then this will be already scoped to this page, and with on this on the CSS selector would not be available for other page.
Oh, so just like this, I don't have to do anything else with the D.
No.
Wow. Okay. And so then that means if I'm understanding this correctly, when I go to look at this, then all of the styles in here, where are they? That's the error page. Which one of these is the actual? Look at that. So this is the scope part. It adds a data attribute so that it only affects, wow, that's really cool. Okay, that's super fun. It does look like it didn't like, maybe I just
didn't
need to
like
reload.
One of the things
I just have to reload. So the hot reload didn't add the data attribute. I just had to reload for that. But holy crap, that is really, really nice. And I like, you know, we're writing class and not class name. It feels like HTML. But Vue does have some specialty stuff, right? Like we can do loops and logic and stuff like that.
Yeah, we can do loop. Like you can do loop on the template itself. Let's say if you have a, let's create an array, then you can use the V4. attribute on the HTML tag. Let's just do a bit of that so people can understand what we're talking about.
Yeah. So how do I get an array?
Okay, let's say we in the export default for view component, you need to have a data.
Okay.
The data is a function that is will create a new instance of data.
Okay.
And then it's return an object.
That's okay.
Inside you can put like let's say images or I don't know what's the array you want to name.
No, images. So actually, images will be great because then we can use it to show off the Cloudinary stuff.
Right.
So do I need a list? Like, so when we do this with Cloudinary, am I providing a list of the public IDs? And I guess we can look at this real quick. Let me get my Cloudinary console up, cloudinary.com, and I'll get logged in. I'm going to pull this off screen real quick while I log in.
Well, okay, just to a quick answer for Nikon, is it? So yeah, in Vue, we can use style component. We have a library called Vue style component, so you can actually write CSS and JS inside the script tag. But unfortunately, it's not working with Vue 3 yet.
Oh, okay.
Almost any other plugin or library for Vue that we actually need to change it to Vue to be more compatible with Tree.
Okay. I think I have somewhere in here. How do I just open this? Open? Store. Here we go. This will help because then we can so these are the images that are currently on.
Oh, Cody! That's cute.
I never talk about this. I always forget it exists, but I do sell stickers. So these are the images being used here. So the LearnWithJSON site is using Cloudinary.
That's so cute.
So these here are the public IDs. This is like what the image is identified by. So
actually, just a correction.
Okay.
It's the public ID, but you need to add the folder before to make it into full public ID.
Oh, okay, good call. So this is in lwj/store. So the full public ID is going to be lwj/store/rubbercorgi.
Right.
Okay. So if I take this and I go out here and I say I want my images, we'll do lwj/store like this. Is this how I use the Cloudinary Nuxt plugin, or do I need to do it a different way?
No, this is how you use it.
Okay, perfect. So let's add a few, and I'll grab the Corgi Pal, and let's grab one more. We'll grab the Boop. Okay, so now we have three images, and if we want to loop through these, how would I do that?
Okay, so
I'm gonna remove some stuff here, actually, just to give us a little more.
I think we can remove the whole documentation and stuff there.
Okay, let's just drop all that out and we're gonna work with just this part. Okay, so my to-do, loop through images. So if I wanna do that, what should I do?
Okay, so let's create a container, a deep container that will contain the whole all the images.
Okay.
I mean, you can use URL also, okay. But I like to use deep.
Okay.
Okay, let's do image tag.
Okay.
Yeah. And do SRC, like source.
Okay.
Go back, V4.
V4, got it.
Yeah. Okay, and say image in images.
Okay, so and that's this, and then, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's already automatically know that this is point to that one. And
we
need a key. So let's do dot key.
Okay, so it's key like this.
Yeah, like that.
Okay.
And equal image, because we have the image, we use up an image. It should be unique enough.
Okay.
And source, dot dot source.
Oh, like this?
Is it the correct? Yeah, okay. And I think we can just, yeah. So now we can just, for now we can put the image inside, because anyway, we want to see how the, if the image will be, the image step will render according to the loop. And then after that, we, I think we will continue with generate the URL for Cloudinary.
Okay, so okay. Do that. And so first, if we save, we get a bunch of broken images, and that's expected. Mm-hmm. But we can see that it created three images, and each one got one of the values from our, let me make this smaller again, one of the values from our array. So in order, rubber corgi, corgi pal, boop. Perfect. Okay. And so that's kind of the, this is the view sort of syntax, right? Is like, if it's a specialty view thing, then it's going to be a V dash. And then, am I correct in assuming that this is like a shorthand?
This is actually the key. The it's not a short. I think it's no. I don't think it's a shorthand, but it's more like a. It's like key in React. When you have to loop in React, you also have key attribute, identifier for this component, so that it know when to re-render it.
And then Nikki in the chat is asking if that's equivalent to the bind key like this.
Yes.
Okay, cool. So great. So then either one will work. It looks like this is a great shortcut for us. That, I mean, and like, this is great. This, I can visually look at this and it makes sense to me. I can see that, you know, I'm getting one image out of images. I know that images is down here. It's all in the same file, so I can find the stuff that I'm doing. That is nice. That's really nice. Okay, so if I want to make this into a Cloudinary image, how do we do that?
Okay, so you can do, because when you install, when we install Cloudinary module, it actually in the background is inject an instant $ Cloudinary to each and every component in the Nuxt project. So you can actually, in the sort, you can write $ Cloudinary. Yep, and dot image dot URL.
Okay.
And open bracket, push the image inside.
Okay, so this is gonna take a public ID into this URL helper function and generate the full URL for me.
Right.
Oh, that's cool. And there we go, it works. Wow. Okay.
Yay!
That was so much faster than I expected it to be. That's amazing. Okay. And so, and like, this is great. And so then if we wanted to take this like a little bit further, we could maybe do, so we've got this container class. Oh, I should probably call this something else. Let's call it image container. And then down here I can do, I think I dropped all of these. So
I just see a book just pop.
Just, yes,
icon just
I have
down.
A
how do you
boop.
Do that?
So that's built with a library called matter.js, and whenever someone uses the boop emoji in chat, it it causes one to drop from the top of the screen. So chat, if you if you want to demonstrate, please spam us with boops for a minute.
I'm going to do it. Wait, I cannot find it. Where is it?
Oh, so that one is, it's only for subscribers. But it's yeah.
I see.
Yeah,
okay,
it's a lot of fun. So we can probably do this as like display grid, and maybe like grid template columns, and we'll do like a repeat 3 1 FR, and then down here we can do a dot image container. Image, and we will make that max width 100%, which I believe will cause this to do what we want. There it is. Yeah, so now it'll fit and it's responsive.
Oh my God, our screen is full of them.
Oh, good. Thanks, chat. Always, you never let me down. I know my bot sub expired. I gotta go fix that. I'm in the process of rebranding. I was calling it StreamBlitz for a long time, and now I'm calling it Socket Studio because StreamBlitz was taken. So I have to go switch over all the things. I just haven't had a chance. But soon, someday, that'll work. In the meantime, so I want to just kind of point out, you know, a few things. First, I love Display Grid. It's magic. But I really like that in Vue, by default, I'm just writing CSS. I'm not having to import a CSS solution. I'm not having to install something or learn a new syntax. I'm just writing the CSS that I was writing anyways in my plain HTML files. But we get these added bonuses of having them scoped and of having the CSS and the JavaScript and the HTML all in one place and, you know, being able to just like reference it right there. So that's a really, really nice, it's a really nice flow. I think it's really pleasant to use.
And if you want to be more organized or you prefer to separate them, you can also separate them in three different files and then combine together, import them together in one tool.
Oh, cool. Okay, yeah. So, and I guess as a code base gets more complex, that probably starts to make sense, right?
Right.
But yes, this is very, very cool. And I'm legitimately blown away by how quickly we were able to get that all integrated. Like we, you know, we inside of what we are 30 minutes in and we've already set up a Nuxt site. We have already integrated Cloudinary and we're already pulling images from my Cloudinary site along with a bunch of messing around. So what a great way to get up and running fast. So what else should we look at here?
You know what? One of the nice things about Vue that we haven't used it yet, that we haven't used the reactive properties.
Yeah.
Let's say.
Yeah, I mean that.
So,
let's do it.
Okay, so let's add a view called computed.
Called computed, and I add that outside of data, right?
Outside of data is the next view.
Okay. And is this computed also a function?
It's an object. Yep. No, it's an object.
Object.
Yeah. So now you can, let's say, Cloudinary image, so we can save the images. Yeah. It's a function, yeah.
Okay, so that's a function.
It's a function, but it cannot be like that. It have to be the other one function because we need this scope.
Got it. Okay. So we'll do it like this.
Not like this.
Not like this.
Yeah. Just a function inside without a function.
It's been so long since I've written it this way that I actually forgot you could do that.
you're too used to React, I guess.
I'm so used to React. Okay.
Yeah. Every time when I switch from React to Vue, I'm like, oh no, I want the JSX. And then when I'm in React, I'm like, I want the Vue things. Okay, let's do it. Return. So you're going to return and we can do like this.images. And you do map.
Map, okay. And then we'll get an image.
Yeah, and then we just use the same code that we use for generating the code, the source code that does the source URL.
Oh, okay. So with this, now I don't have to run this up here. I can instead do Cloudinary images like this.
Yeah.
And then we can just go back to a plain old image.
Yep, and then just use image.
Oh, that's really slick.
It makes it more cleaner. Need to return it, I think.
Is it this dot? This dot, yep.
No, this dot. If you do it inside, I have to do this dot, yeah. but still need to do return, I think, because this is
That's right. Yeah. Oops. There we go. Okay. All right. I've completely forgotten how to write non-React JavaScript as evidenced by this. But yeah, okay, so now we're here. We're getting the same result, but our markup is a little bit cleaner, which I think is nice. I like the idea of not calling functions in my attributes. And this is nice because this looks like what I would expect. We're running a little bit of business logic as JavaScript, not in line. Right. And that's nice and clean. Okay.
And every time, the nice thing about reactivity of view is that allow you mentioned something like a variable inside with this mm-hmm. that attached to this or attached data. If the variable change, then this whole computed property will be called again. So it's like reactive will call again and then try to compute the new value of it. So it's done automatically.
Nice.
It, data is like the local state. In React.
So that means then I should be able to I could put an input or something in here and add that to choose another public ID, and it would add it to the list.
Yeah, I think so.
Should we give that a try? Do you think?
Yeah, why not?
All right, let's do it. Okay, so we will. I will add, I guess, just a form element, and. Inside of that, we'll do an input, and we'll call it type text. We'll give it an ID of, give it sticker ID, we'll make it camel case, and name sticker ID. Okay, now I didn't do any view things. I just set up some basic markup, but what I think this will give us is the ability to just enter any sticker public ID in that, and we want that to add to the array. So if I'm going to do that, how would one go about doing that?
Okay, so first we need to attach it with the event listener, or you want to click on the button to submit it. Okay,
that's probably easier, right? So that way we don't get a bunch of broken images while we type.
Right. So first of all, in input, we need to attach to data the local state, a local variable. So let's just go back to the data and declare a new variable.
Okay.
Probably input.
Input. Oh, that's better. Yeah. And leave it empty to start.
Yeah, leave it empty to start.
Okay.
And when you go up to the template, we're using something called V model. My English. I've been staying at home for so long. Okay. equals to input. Yeah. So this means that you actually tell view to attach to bind two-way binding where with the input input variable with the input view. So whatever value that will type in inside the input, it will automatically put into the variable.
That's really slick because even with the extra ergonomics of something like React hooks, you still need a few lines of code to make that work. So the fact that this is just declare it here, link it up here, and it's done, that's pretty slick. That's really nice.
Right. And now we need to add another functions to attach to the click on the button, right?
Okay.
So in view, all the functionality will be added inside an object called methods. So let's declare methods, an object inside. Methods with this, yeah.
Like that?
No, methods like...
Methods, sorry. That's my, yeah. Okay, so we've got methods, and then we do... Is it any name we want?
Yeah, any name you want.
Okay.
Like so, like a declare a new function.
Like this.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then you can do this dot images and push this sticker. Maybe we should
call it input,
empty,
right?
Enough. Input. Yeah.
Oh yeah, and we can check if this input dot length is greater than 0. Okay. And otherwise, mm-hmm. Do we have to handle a no op case, or it'll just do nothing, right?
Wait, this input is an op is an array?
No, it's a string, but if we do a
right, yeah.
But yeah, so I
normally I use the input if it, the exclamable marks, like that input. One?
Oh, yeah. We can also do that. Like that, you mean?
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah. I'm up for whatever. I think that one might just be whatever we prefer is probably going to be fine in this case.
It's really fine though. Actually, it's fine anyway. So okay. So let's attach the bind of the on click input. On click.
And is it like on
event?
On like
on submit. No, we will do how say dot not studa like this side.
Wait, this one.
At yeah, this side.
Like that.
Yeah, and that's then is, yeah, submit equal.
And we called it.
And
save
then
sticker.
Put the function name inside.
Okay.
You can also write v dash on equal v dash on dot dot submit equal something, but this is like the shorthand version of it.
Nice. Okay. Cool. So this then is equivalent to this.
Yeah. And if you want to make sure that it would not escalate propaganda. Oh my
propagate?
God, my English. Propagate. I feel so ashamed of my English recently. It's so bad.
I can barely speak English, and it's the only language I can speak. So you're killing it.
You know, every time I speak, like, I have three different versions of translation inside my head, and I have to choose it to know which one I'm going to go back. Yeah. So don't be surprised if I throw Hebrew in the middle of the conversation and you know what I'm talking about. I am in the midst. Okay. So it's submitted in order to stop propagate or prevent default.
Uh-huh.
Vue actually provide a shorthand also for that, so you can do submit dot prevent. I think it's submit dot prevent.
Wow! Yeah.
And then it will already not go into propagate.
Wow! That okay? So that's legit. Like how cool is that? That like. Of course, when you're doing JavaScript, you're very frequently going to be preventing the default action of click events. Like that's what writing single page apps ultimately is all about, is taking over browser behavior. So how cool is it to build that right in?
And also, if you want to make sure that you only submit once, like you only trigger the event once, you can do like submit dot once, I think.
Like all together or?
You can do something like that. I think prevent dot one. Yeah.
Wow.
Chaining, yeah.
This is really, really cool. Okay. So that's really nice. And then I think I need to add just some light styling here because it looks like it deleted a lot of my stuff. So let's go up here. We'll add a class of input and a class of button. And then down here, we can do input, and we'll just do like a border of 1 pixel solid black. And then for the button, we can do color white. We'll do a background of black, and that's probably good enough. Let's see how that works. Add a little bit of padding. That's a little rough to look at.
Okay, Ben is asking, what things do you miss from React when writing Vue? Oh, well, a lot of things. hooks.
Hooks? Nah. Yeah.
Hooks, yeah. Also, I like the JSX. Sometimes you just like it's much easier when you actually write everything inside together, so you can fix it. You don't have to scroll up, scroll down, scroll up, scroll down to go to template to fix it. And yeah, composition API is view tree. It looks very promising also. And what else? A bunch of other things in React Redux.
It's also like, I think it's just really cool that, I love that we're actually spoiled for choice. I think that one of the things that always pushes innovation, right, is like React came out with hooks and then Vue adopted the best ideas of that into the composition API. And, you know, Vue's single file components have driven, I think, a lot of innovations in the React space to try to keep that similarly good DX. And I think everybody borrowed the best ideas from Angular. So I think it's really, really interesting. I really like the idea of like the community working to like share the best ideas, push each other forward, make sure we don't get away with settling down and getting lazy and forcing people to do things that are bad just because there's no competition, right? I think I love that the developers are trying everything and pushing each other forward. So now, if this works, I should be able to add a fourth sticker just by, is that the right thing? Can't remember if that's the actual prefix. I've forgotten now. Here's our images and it is lwj/store. Yes. Okay. Here goes nothing.
Just by the way, I'm just talking about the people in the comments. Well, Vuex is definitely better than Redux. Sorry, opinionated.
That's what we're here for. We're here to learn. We're here to have opinions. But it worked. Look at that. It worked on the first try, which that's rare. So
if you're using Vue, this is not something that you'll be surprised that like most of the time works on first try until you add something more complex.
LWJ store, and we can add, and there we go. This is really nice. Oh, it. I think the once we shouldn't have used because it.
We should remove the once because it means that it's only allow you to click once.
Okay, so we can do that, and then maybe what we can do down here instead is if there's an input, we'll set it, and then we'll set this input to empty.
Right.
And so now, if I reload this. Let's try it. We'll do LWJ store learn with JSON. I'm going to click. Good. Let's do, now it's empty. So LWJ store bearded corgi. Excellent. Okay. There we go. We've now built a full kind of input output thing where we've bound data in Vue to a dynamic array, so that we can compute that using Cloudinary to get images. And these images are all hosted on Cloudinary. So we can see here, this is one of my favorite things about Cloudinary is that everything is done through a URL. So I have my cloud here and it's all hosted on res.cloudinary.com. It's an image upload. And then there's a couple basics. So do you want to talk about what these are?
Yeah, this is actually in the Nuxt Cloudinary module where we add something by default. This is the default when you use the URL function of the Cloudinary module, which auto mean that it's the fetch, the format they will return to you, it will be automatic, which means the Cloudinary will detect which browser it is and what kind of format will be most like optimal for the asset. So let's say in WebP, it will return a WebP. And in other, in Safari, it will return a JP2, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so that's done automatically. You don't have to do anything for that.
And we can see here that this has happened, right? So this asset, if we go and look at the Corgi, this was uploaded as a PNG. And if I take this out, so I'll take both of these out, then we can see that I got back a, here's an image PNG, it's 34.5 kilobytes roughly. And then if I go back and I reload, it's now 13.8 kilobytes and we got back an image WebP. And all we had to do was add this F auto. And then can you say what the Q auto does?
The Q auto means the quality of the image. Let's say if you are in mobile, then you don't really need a very big resolution because in mobile, the screen size is very limited. And but calculate the correct resolution is not that easy. So what it does is that when you send it to Cloudinary, it's with Q auto, Cloudinary will know that the device of the user, what kind of device it is, like what kind of the resolution, what kind of the mobile device, and then will return the image with the format and with the quality that match the will look the best on that device, and mm-hmm. mean that also your size will be much smaller.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So this is really nice, right? So we so now we've got all of that. We are loading images. They're being automatically optimized, automatically sent in the right format. Henri, I saw your question about Safari 14. I just tried it. It looks like Safari is still doing PNG, not WebP.
Really? I tried my Safari the other day, and it told me it gave me JPEG 2.
Also, may have been. I don't know if I've updated Safari in a very long time. So it might be that I'm using an outdated version of Safari. So if anybody in the chat wants to test that, give it a try. I'll give you a link so you can try that.
Oh, you can. Sorry. In the chat, someone asked if Aviv. Yes, in a Cloudinary, you can actually force to use Aviv. I think you can try it with Aviv, and then it will return to you the Aviv one, maybe.
Okay. Yeah. But yeah, so I think Henri's just he's in there testing. But yeah, so lots of cool things, lots of really interesting opportunities here. And so now what we've done is we have built a Nuxt page. And so one of the things that's interesting about Nuxt is that Nuxt gives us the ability to do like static generation or server side generation. We chose the static mode. What does that mean, and like, how is that different from regular Vue?
Well, sorry. First of all, Nuxt is server-side rendering, which means everything you saw right now, when it's deployed, is actually server-side. It pre-rendered as a static HTML, and then it's served to client-side.
Okay.
Unless it's something that you want to do on client. So it's not only Vue, it's Vue on top of Vue. And static side means that it will not do anything like dynamic page. It will actually view everything in static, pre-generate all the routes that you have, and mm-hmm. then deploy Netlify, and this way you have all the sites already static.
Nice. And, okay. So this, what then, we've just done with all of the kind of computed fields and all of this dynamic stuff that we've done, we can deploy this to Netlify?
Yeah, I think so.
Maybe we should just give this a shot. Let's see what happens. So I'm in, there is no git remote, so let's git create learn with JSON. Let's learn Nuxt. And that's going to give
me. Someone asking if Nuxt is a copy of Next. Well, you know what? The only thing about Nuxt and Next is that they both server side rendering, and when you type Nuxt on Google, it will auto correct you to Next.
Okay, but, so I'm just what I'm doing right now is I'm just deploying this to Git so that we can get it up on Netlify real quick. So. Let's call this a work in progress, trying out deploys, and then I'm going to git push. We're going to set the upstream so that I don't have to keep typing it out to origin master. No, origin main. forgot. I've changed my defaults, but my brain is still learning the defaults. So
I
now
think you're going to show up the Netlify CLI.
So I can run. I've got the Netlify CLI installed, so I'm going to run Netlify init, and it's going to. I'm going to create and configure a new site. I'm going to go to my account, and we'll call this Let's Learn Nuxt. Okay, so it's now created a site, and my build command. I actually don't know my build command, so let's look. To build, I need build. So we will run yarn build.
Generate.
Okay, I'll have to go fix that then. And then do I need, let's see, the directory to deploy. Do you know where it generates to? Is it like public or dist or something like that?
I think it dist.
Dist, okay.
Yeah, by default it's dist, I think.
Okay, so that's built, and then I need to go fix it, so I'm gonna run Netlify open.
That one the jet has right been to... trying to tell you to change it to your generate.
Okay, so then build and deploy. It's gonna ask me for all of my stuff. I'm going to change this to generate. And we'll save it. And then I can go back out here. And it says that it's building, but we know that one's going to break because it ran the wrong command. So instead, I'm going to go back out here and just start a new one. And hopefully, this should be nice and quick. But yeah, so generate. So running build would like, that's for if it's going to run on a server, right? It'll be... expecting to go to node, and then generate is what takes all of that and runs it through static site generation so that it becomes static assets. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Excellent. Okay. So this first build will be a little bit slower. We got to install all of our node modules and all that good stuff.
Also, the nice thing about Nuxt, the newer version is that it has two separate processes. So if you make some change only on the content, on the content, let's say if you have a content separately, then it will already know that the code haven't changed. So using the catch view from the previous build, and then it will shorten the second deployment only on building the static site.
Oh, nice.
They generate the static HTML.
Excellent. Okay. So we're running our Nuxt generate here. And not sure how long that's supposed to take. Let's run it locally too and just take a look. Okay, so it's got some Cloudinary stuff. Oh, it's done. Okay.
So that's fine.
Here's our site. So we can go and look at this. And there we go. It's live. So now... if we go out here, and then we can do all the same thing. So LWJ store, we'll just add the boop again. Or LWJ store bearded corgi, right? So we've got all the interactivity is there. We've got the ability to add more stickers as we go. Like this is nice. And this is all running in a way that if I do view source, we can see this is in the HTML, so I can come out here and I can actually disable JavaScript. So let's do that if I can find it. Where is it? Disable JavaScript.
Right there. Yeah.
Right, and then when I reload, now I won't be able to add these because we're using JavaScript for that.
Right.
But the core of the site works, and this is the appeal of static site generation is that we're getting to a point where the majority of the site is going to work. If we're serving a blog or marketing pages, if we're serving an app, we can get a lot of content that doesn't change between views to somebody without requiring any JavaScript. And then we can use JavaScript to enhance it so that we get extra capabilities. So that's really nice. What should we do next, do you think?
Well, let's say I haven't seen everyone with that kind of asking what the difference between Nuxt. The nice thing about Nuxt is that you can actually fetch dynamic content before you serve in the site, and it's still working even when you disable JavaScript on the client side.
I would love to give that a try.
So let's just add something called async data. Async.
It like out here.
Async. Anyway, async data. Yeah.
Okay.
And let's do. And async data is the function that will be called when on the header, like before the page is served to the client.
Okay.
So it it will get all the data and like external API icon, external things that you want to have, and it will not run on the client side alone.
Okay.
So let's say, but async data, because it's called before the component is generated, so you don't have the disk, but you can have, it receives an object called context. So in the object context as the parent, in the parameter, you can put a context, so ever, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So you can actually do the same. Let's say you can take Cloudinary, the image. Basically, you can use the same syntax, like let's go this image in above.
This image is like this?
No, not this image. Let's just do, create an array of image. Just a normal array, and instead of this, we don't have this here, so.
Okay. So I have my images, and then am I returning this?
Yeah, you can return that.
Okay, and then I've got an array.
Basically, you return this one means that you return the local state, the data of the local state for this component.
Okay. And so we can, so we basically just, instead of returning it in, or we'll return it in both, or is it?
You can do both, but if you use an async data, then you don't have to do the other way. The other one is just for declare that you have a field that called input, images, maybe.
Got it. Okay. And so if we wanted to, then what we could also do is like we could send out a call. I don't know if we have fetch installed here, but we could do like images equals like await fetch.
Yeah, something like that also can do.
Get my images or whatever it would be. Right. And that would run, we can just do that real quick to show it. So here is an API that I love because it's very fast. They give us the ability, let's use the REST one this time. And that's not what I wanted. We want the characters. So we can get one character and we'll get back an image. And so we can just show that one image. So let's grab this character. I think if we do one, yeah. So if we do just this one, that'll give us a single character we can use. And so we should be able to, I think, can I make this async?
You need to add the async in front, yeah.
Okay, so then I should be able to do like Rick equals await fetch. Let me make this bigger so we can see what we're doing.
So basically, this one will return the new data, and then the Nuxt will merge both data from the async data and the data from the local component itself together.
Oh, interesting. Okay. So to start, I probably just want to do it like this because this is going to break our Cloudinary stuff. Mm-hmm. So we can maybe just see what happens if we do this. Does that seem right?
Right. Take a look.
Okay. And then if I want to display this, like let's just dump the data. Do I need to do anything special, or is there like a, can I do like this?
Yeah, you can do like that.
Okay, so let's try and see what happens. I'm going to, is this running? I think that's running. So I'm gonna come out here.
It's already run, right?
There it is. Oh, look at that. Okay, so now we have our image, and so we can pull that out and do something like Was it just like rick.image or is it
.image? Wait, is this an image with the URL? Oh, now you can use a fetch URL if you have the fetch
that
on.
That was what I was thinking, right? And so now that we've got this, we can do, let's say like, or let's move this to the bottom. So we'll kind of work in descending order down here. So container template, I got to move this. No, that's fine. So we'll have an image and the source will be the rick.image, I think it is, yes. And the alt will just hard code to be Rick Sanchez. And that, I think, should give us an image. Nope, that one's broken. What did I break? Get me in here. And I missed.
You need to have a dot dot.
Yeah, that's my bad. I forgot.
Something I also missed in React. In React, you can just write it and then do the bracket, and that will be the already inside. In Vue, you missed out the dot dot. That we love.
I wonder what happens if I just like double container this. Is this going to explode? Tune in to find out. Div, don't need whatever that was. Oh, we can't. Oh, exactly one root. Okay, never mind. Can't do that. Let's bring this up here, and that's. Don't betray me.
In Vue, you have to have a one root, a single root rules. But I think in Vue 3 already support that you have two root. Don't quote me for that. I don't remember exactly.
Okay, and then I'm just gonna bump this down to be display block width 100%. Is that gonna take it out of the flow? What are you wrapped in? What did I do? Is this like display grid or something?
Oh, I think container. You have a flex display in the container.
Got it. Okay, yeah. So it's just. It's doing a, how about this? We'll say flex direction column, and that should go vertically. There we go. Okay, so now we've got our Rick image is being pulled in, but we can see this is being pulled in from here. And so it's, first of all, we're hot linking to the Rick and Morty API, which is not really a cool, it's better to not do that. And we don't have any of the optimization stuff that we're getting on our other images where they're being auto formatted, auto quality. So can you show me what would we do if we wanted to, like this remote image, if I want to pull that in, how can we use that?
Okay, so let's go back to the case. In the Nuxt, as in the Cloudinary module, we have something called a fetch remote, which you need to do is call image.fetch remote, pass the URL and whatever option, whatever transformation you want to have. So, and that would do the all the works for you.
Okay, so then I would do, can I do it in async data or do I do it in computed data?
No, computed, no, you can do it in async data. It's actually, okay. You can do it in async data also. Don't need the computed one.
So it would be image, or no, Cloudinary.
Cloudinary.
Okay. All right. Lots of things just clicked in my brain. So in async data, context is taking the place of this.
Yeah.
Exactly. Got it. Okay. So then it was Cloudinary dot image.
Image. Yeah.
Okay.
And fetch remote.
Like this.
Yeah. And just pass the URL inside.
Okay, and then I need to rewrite this because it's no longer rick.image, it's now just Rick. Okay.
Okay, and let's stay a look.
Okay. And so now this has been fetched. So I'll open this in a new tab. And we can see that it is on Cloudinary, it's using my cloud, and then instead of image upload, it's image fetch. We still got the format auto, quality auto, but then we just pass in the URL. Which right. This is slick. So now what this means, if I understand correctly, is I have effectively said, I want to upload this image, but the URL has ceased to matter. Like this website could now go down, but I would still be able to use this URL.
Right, exactly.
That is slick. And we're not hot linking anymore. So we're not hitting the Rick and Morty API and like taking their bandwidth. We're now using our own Cloudinary account. We're optimizing it. We're cutting down on its size. That's really nice.
And it's catch, yeah.
And so one thing that I wanna check on is like, what if I wanna modify this a little bit? Like what if I wanna make it, what if I want everything on the site to be grayscale? Can I just do that?
Yeah, you absolutely can do that. Just add another, just add an object with the effect that you want. And that's an additional parameter in the fetch remote.
Like here?
Second param. Okay. So just add an object. And let's say you want a grayscale, right? So yeah. Let's do an effect. And grayscale.
Like that?
Yeah, just like that.
And that's all?
Mm-hmm.
Exactly. Ooh. Okay, let's go back out here and look at it. And there we go. Grayscale.
Here you go.
Grayscale Rick. And if we look at this, this is the thing that made me fall in love with Cloudinary is notice we're still doing F auto, Q auto, but now we just added this E grayscale and it like just works. And so we can do all sorts of stuff with this, right? Like if I want to make it smaller, I can do like width 50. And now we've right. got a little one. Or if right. what are some fun ones? What are your favorite effects?
Oh wow! My favorite, like my most used one, is to do like make it into a round circle.
Okay.
And add some. Okay, so do R max
like that.
Radius max. Yep. And let's add a little bit of crop time. Ah, this one already cropped, so it doesn't really matter. See, thumb.
Thumb?
Yeah, thumb.
Okay.
And you have a width 50.
Look at it. That is beautiful. Like, it's
basically
such
what it does. Sorry. Basically, what it does is that see thumb mean that it actually cropped as a thumbnail on your face. If it detects the face, like
oh.
an object. Yeah.
So, okay, so let's go look at an actual face. Let's see, here's a media library. I think somewhere in here I have pictures of my face. I have so much nonsense in here. Let's see. here's a picture of Marissa's face. This is a good one. Let's crop on Marissa. So if I go in here and I say, it goes after the upload, right? So I create
right.
a block. And then you said R max C thumb, and let's just make it width 200. Oh no!
Now you need to put the height, I think.
Oh, okay. Oh, because it automatically set all that detail. Okay, so,
yeah.
Or height of 200. And then I want to force this to be a PNG, so I'm going to do that. And now it's yeah, cropped to it's, the interest.
But now that one is not exactly correct, right? So let's to change it a bit. Let's say change to G under G face. I think it's G face.
I think that sounds right. G face. And that's for G is for gravity, is that right?
Yeah.
Look at that. So now how cool is this? Like this is the part that blows my mind. Is if we're trying to do like author photos or we're trying to like aggregate data and get something up and quickly that looks kind of uniform by setting this gravity face, I didn't have to go and manually edit all of these different things, all these different images. If I had, you know, 50 speaker photos or whatever, and they all just uploaded to a form, this means that in addition to like, you know, and then I can set the Q auto and the F auto. Now, what I've done with this is I have styled my speaker images. I have made them into thumbnails. I've focused on the author's face. I've set the right size. I've optimized for speed and format. And all of that was done by just setting this in my URL. And we can set all of this through here as well. Is that correct? If we wanted to.
Right. So you can do gravity. Gravity is, yep.
And then
radius, we type 200 and radius.
Is just max like this?
Yeah, just max.
Okay. Did we need anything else?
I think maybe we need to, that's it. Maybe what does it crop? Maybe I don't remember.
This one looks okay. So that one's doing what we want. I think we might have needed the crop thumb. And then we could also, like, we could do this with, we could do Marissa's as well and just copy this whole thing and put one in here. And then let's get the original version. So we'll delete.
Okay, so just to answer, so I would ask this, running the static generation against create another rig on Cloudinary. Nope, it's only create one.
Okay, I don't know what's going to happen when I do this, so we're... Or wait, can I just do this with like a regular image, like an image URL?
Then you can do that, and then you have to pass under... In the object, you need to pass type.
Type.
Wait, this one already Cloudinary, so never mind.
Yeah. So this one, I think this will just work. Let's try it. And then I'm going to go up here and I'll just duplicate the Rick and we'll change this out to Marissa.
So thumb in thumbnail, it's trying to crop it at the thumbnail. So most of the time it's working up. Like if your picture is clear enough and it will try to crop like most of your body and your face, but if you have something like Marissa with a newspaper obviously bigger than the Marissa, then it will just crop the newspaper instead.
Yeah, I mean, and this is so much fun, like all the different things you can do. And you know, there are things that you can do with this that are really powerful that we're not touching on. Like you can add text overlays and you can do like interesting color things, like add gradients or do two tones or stuff like that. It's super, super fun.
Let me find my in Cloudinary. I have in the page of Cloudinary we have the team page and everyone have to go with their favorite overlay. So I have one with me and the Sailor Moon together on overlay on top of me. Maybe I can find it.
I don't know if this is going to do what I want, but let's see. Yeah, that looks better. Okay.
So let's throw this one real quick. Yeah, so this is the one that I'm using.
Okay, let's get that one pulled up.
Anna, the Cloudinary is free.
Oh, wow. And if you want to get into Cloudinary, you can get started at this link, I think, jason.af/cloudinary. And that'll just let Cloudinary know that you saw through this show. And it doesn't change anything else. It's still free. I think Cloudinary gives me a small monetary compensation in result for using that link. So if you're thinking about Cloudinary, clicking that link helps me out a little bit, which is very nice. This is blowing my mind with how awesome it is.
You haven't seen the other one. Like they have people that do some kind of like like the whole video itself. They with the picture of an overlay of a video on the picture. This is an overlay of a GIF for the picture.
Yeah, but so this is what's interesting is, so what you've done here is you have like added two images together, and you're doing all of that through the API. So we start with this Sailor Moon, and then. I think, is it the L is what brings in another photo?
Yeah, L is mean the layer, which mean you start with an L underline, and then you put the whole public ID of the other photo. That will make the whole, that will put another layer on top of your image.
Mm-hmm.
And width, and then you have effect blur, which means this way you can see that it's at kind of 50% blur in this case. If not, then it will be on top of each other, so you cannot see my face.
Yeah. Well, that's, I mean, this is, yeah, this is really, really cool. I think, you know, I'm very, very, very blown away by just like how much you get out of the box, both with Nuxt, and you know, how quickly we were able, actually, let's go ahead and deploy this. So we can get add everything. We'll get commit and say add fetched images and effects. And let's get this thing live. So I'm going to get push. And then back on our Netlify page, we'll see that it picked that up on the push. So it's going to start building for us. And then here in just a few, probably a minute or two, we'll have a new deploy of the site. In the meantime, I think that's a great stopping point. So let's start sharing some links and stuff. So make sure you go and follow Maya on Twitter, like I said. You can get started with Nuxt on the Nuxt website. Here's a link to the Getting Started docs. And you can get started with Cloudinary at cloudinary.com, or I'm gonna drop my link one more time. It's jason.af/cloudinary. And make sure you go check out the cloudinary.nuxtjs.org module. That is super powerful, super fun. And another quick shout out to the sponsors. The sponsorship today comes from Netlify, Fauna, Sanity, and Auth0, which enables us to bring in white coat captioning to do live captions, which makes the show more accessible. It gives us the ability to include transcripts with the show when we post it on the website. And I'm just so grateful that enough people get enough value out of the show that sponsorship is even in the realm of reality. Maya, if somebody wants to go further, where would you recommend they go from here?
Like with Nuxt or?
With anything, Cloud. Just any helpful resources with Nuxt, with Cloudinary, anything like that.
I would, for Nuxt, I think if you want to study about Nuxt, then we have a Vue Spoon or ViewMaster. Let me take a look if we have some.
Maybe is it ViewMastery?
ViewMastery or ViewSchool, they both have a great class. I think ViewMastery are more for a beginner. So if you you haven't known about Nuxt and you want to get started, this is a great resource for that. ViewSchool is having also basic and also have extra more advanced course on Nuxt also. So you definitely should check it out. But this is a great resource for study. I'm not sure about front-end master. Maybe there's some course in front-end master, but I'm not so familiar with that yet.
That is a great question. Let's see if anyone's done Nuxt on.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, new look application. At Sarah.
Hey, Sarah Dresner. She's in the she's the chat right now.
I'm not sure if Sarah's in the chat right now, but she is an excellent teacher, one of my favorite teachers in the world. So
You
have a front-end master subscription, you should absolutely go check this one out. It's going to be very in-depth, very good.
And yes, if you haven't, I would want to show out, like if you want to do something like a block or some documentation, like the one you saw with Nuxt Cloudinary module. Mm-hmm. So you definitely should check out the content module of Nuxt, which is gave you all the out-of-the-box features that you can ask for.
Very cool.
To create documentation, create blog posts. It's super great.
Cool. Yeah. So Maya, what if people want to keep up with you? We've shared your Twitter. I'm going to drop that link one more time. Where else should people go if they want to keep up with you?
You can go to my Facebook, I guess. My Facebook or my GitHub. I'm not so active. I'm not so active on Facebook.
Okay.
My Facebook page is not so active.
Is it the same username on GitHub?
Yeah.
Okay.
On GitHub.
All right. Yeah. This has been so much fun. Thank you so much for taking time out of your day to come hang out and teach with us today. Any
Jason.
Parting words? Anything else you want to share with us before we go?
Nuxt is awesome. So you definitely should check out Nuxt if you haven't to. I mean, if you like Nuxt or you like Gatsby, it's also okay. I like all of them, but let's go Nuxt. We need more Nuxt and Nuxtifier.
Absolutely.
And yeah, so And Nuxt and Cloudinary is awesome. And I'm working on more things together with Cloudinary. And Nuxt image, we have a Nuxt image component, similar like Gatsby image component or Next image component.
Yeah.
So that is on the way. I hope I'm allowed to share that.
Yeah, absolutely. So, like, we love secrets on this show.
I just hope that Debbie will not come send me a message and say, oh, no, Maya, you're not supposed to tell that.
Oh, no, that's
either
great.
Way, yeah, and yeah, I'm working on a data layer, GraphQL data layer for Cloudinary.
Ooh.
So, yep.
Nice. So, that is super slick. Well, I am so pumped to see all of that and we will have to talk about having you come back on to talk about the GraphQL layer, because that is so much fun. I had an absolute blast. I hope you had fun. Chat, I hope you had a great time. Make sure you check out the schedule for upcoming shows. We have a whole bunch of really excellent content coming up. We are going to have Lindsay Kopach come on the show and teach us all about building an accessible audio player in React later this week. That one's going to be super fun.
That's cool.
Oh, I'm so excited. It's going to be great. Lindsay just dropped an ebook actually that is all about writing accessible code. And I'm really, really excited to have her come on. We've got Adam Barrett coming on to teach us about static site workflows with NX. So NX is something that I thought was only for monorepos, but it turns out there's a whole lot more. So Adam's going to teach us all about that. And then David East is rejoining the show, and we're going to do a soundboard, like a multiplayer soundboard. This one's going to be wild. So make sure you join live, because part of the show is by the end, we want everyone to be making noise on each other's laptops as we all work together on this. So this one is going to be especially fun to tune in for live. And you know, just go scan through. There's so much fun stuff coming up. I really want to see everybody here. With that, I'm going to call this one done. Maya, thank you again. Chat, thank you so much. Stay tuned. We're going to go and raid Shirley Wu, who is live right now. Thank you so much. We will see you next time.
It was so much fun. Thank you very much.